You kinda scared yourself, you turn and run. But if you have a change of heart.
All right, welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. You can text us at that same number. It's Wednesday. That means Wednesdays with my guest, Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of
Citizen Action.
Citizen Action. Hey, how you doing, Dr. Kraig?
Good. I took a week off, stayed in New Mexico, so I've been biking and hiking.
Wow. It's, what is the weather's got to be? Toasty,
80s,
huh?
Into upper mid to upper 80s, but dry heat. I went to their Palace of Governors yesterday, Earl. I had no idea. It was first built in 1610
by
the Spanish when it was a colonial outpost, and they've kept changing the building, but they've tried to bring it back to its original, but it's a museum now. But it's amazing. It puts nothing that old in Wisconsin.
So is it, so it has to be made of clay? What is it made of?
It's made of stone, but it looks very kind of combination Spanish mission and adobe style. It's gone through all iterations. They actually had to excavate big parts of it because it had, and found new rooms and things like that. But they've restored it.
You know, Dr. Kraig, since you're down that way, I just got through having a discussion about Phoenix, Arizona, where 645 people have died last year. And a lot of it is because people are homeless and they're living. How is it possible, Dr. Kraig, that in Phoenix, Arizona, people are homeless and living on the street and people are aware? Why do we allow that kind of stuff to happen?
That's a great moral question, right, Earl, as to...
Yeah.
It's amazing in our society how many people who have a lot of power can deny any responsibility. And I think the first step in social ethics is to think about, both a collective responsibility and individual responsibility. Now, it doesn't mean necessarily, private charity. It can mean being involved in trying to create a society that cares for the least among us, as Jesus called upon us to do. But I just say that I was in Phoenix in December, and you can see it there, but you can see it even more here in New Mexico. New Mexico is one of the poorer states in the union, very diverse population. And it's like Albuquerque, where I am, is like a gated city. The Quality Inn that I'm in, which is not this is not a Marriott, right? This is not a Hilton, right? Has automatic gates on the parking lot. It's like everything is like a gated community around here because there are so many poor and homeless people. Even the working class has gated itself off. And they have apparently, disinvested here in mental health, the Republican governor they had. And so that surged the number of homeless people. So, and we're in this situation as we watch Donald Trump's trial, that we have a movement that's built on othering people who are less disadvantaged and making them the enemy. And that is exactly what will fuel even worse kind of consequences.
You know, Dr. Kraig, there was a time when the church in this nation and the churches were so well organized that, and the time that our nation said, well, we'll forego this because we'll allow the churches to address these kinds of issues. And the churches aren't in a position to do this anymore, right? Because the problem is so huge that it's going to require the nation itself to address some of these issues, humanitarian issues that happen on our streets, right? You know, humanitarian, it can't be. So we've got, I'm having one of those senior moments when there's a major, you know, hurricane and all those kind of things. And then we have,
natural disaster.
And then we have the name of that thing that comes in, to deal with all that. I forgot what it's called.
FEMA, right.
Federal emergency. But, you know, Dr. Kraig, you know, people struggling in this country, in cities and states across this entire nation, are in tremendous need. I will say this, and, you know, I was on Memorial Day, or the day before that, I was a part of a block party, huge block party, and barbecued 30 pounds of chicken. And for the people at the block party, and a 10-year-old girl came up to me and she said, "Sir," really, yes, well-spoken young lady, I'm hungry and my mother's over there and I've got 6 siblings. Do you think we could have some of that chicken for dinner? We'll make it our dinner." And my heart bled, Dr. Kraig, because guess what? She said, "Well, our food stamps aren't coming until, you know, next month." And here's this family, and the mother's in it over her head, Dr. Kraig, and somehow they slipped through the cracks. An entire family, Dr. Kraig. So I guess what I'm asking you is, and I know you're a moral guy, you're a moral man, why can't we do better in this country? Why won't we do better?
We could. There's still a possibility, right? And there are a lot of people like you and I and a lot of most of your listeners who agree. First, you have to lean in. You have to start with a place of love for all humanity. And so your description of how your heart bled for that little girl and her family, that is exactly how we should ground this. You are right that not only can private charity from churches, secular sources, not handle the problem. If you want to be fact-based, real research back 150 years in the United States and Europe shows it is never taken care of poverty. It's always been a drop in the bucket. It's always required collective action through government. And the problem is we have a right-wing ideology that denies that and is not fact-based. And it's this non-fact-based element of it goes way back, way beyond Donald Trump. I mean, Ronald Reagan retold the Good Samaritan story, a Jesus story, to say that Jesus didn't say, "Go get government bureaucrats out to help. Go and individually help that man on the road."
Right.
Now, that was a nice rationalization for pulling up the social safety net, right, and creating the spike in homelessness and deinstitutionalizing mental health, everything else, which would have been okay if you had invested the same amount in non-institutionalized mental health. That wasn't done. Instead, we built prisons, and that was the place where we didn't really de-institutionalize mental health. We moved people to corrections, right, instead of cure, even misguided curative efforts, such as institutional mental health. So you have a split in most of the major world religions, certainly in Christianity, Catholicism, Judaism, between a right and a left wing, Earl. And part of the problem is that the right wing of Christianity is the bedrock of the Trump coalition. And all of them are losing ground in the United States. The largest group is the unchurched. And unfortunately, the liberal religions have lost ground even more. But the evangelical Christians have gone from 25% of the population to 15% and falling. There are some analysts who think that this election is their last gasp to take control control so they can impose their morality. And there's a great book by a theologian called The Republican Jesus that shows how this version of Christianity has really distorted Christian teachings and made it into a right-wing political ideology. And this is a serious theologian that goes through the actual interpretation of the text and its social context and shows how absurd things such as Reagan's version of the Good Samaritan story is. So we have to cut through that. And the only way to do that is to build the power in love, and that's what social justice movements are, to both win the political fight and then to do what we know we need to do to create a just society. I mean, we know what we need to do, but it's a matter of getting around all the denial and all those who capitalize on hatred, which is a perversion of love, because hatred, Earl, is about, I need to protect my family from this evil thing, right? So it's grounded in some good principle. We, you know, we need to protect our families, our friends, our communities. The problem is the perversion is the idea of who the enemy is, the least among us, people who are undocumented, anyone who wants to do good in the world, as opposed to just grab all that they can, which is what the reigning business ideology is, starting with Milton Friedman in this country.
You know, Dr. Kraig, man, you say it so rightly. You know, it's why I love having you on and listening to you, because you explain it, you know, in a manner that we can understand. 844-967-2789. My guest is Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action. Dr. Kraig, after this short hiatus, we're going to talk about the fact that the Republican Party that's having their convention in Milwaukee doesn't want any problems. We don't want anybody to be able to say anything about what's going on. This is our time to shine. 844-967-2789. Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action on the Earl Ingram Show. All right, welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. It's Wednesday. That means Wednesdays with my special guest, Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action. So, Dr. Kraig, so last week, so here's what Republicans want to do. They've got the convention in Milwaukee, and they want unfettered, you know, opportunities to say whatever it is they want to say without any pushback, because we have come into town, we're the great Republicans, and we're going to control everything around here because we're the Republicans. We brought this convention to Milwaukee. So let us do whatever it is we want to do. Last week, the Republican National Committee demanded that the United States Secret Service, Dr. Kraig, demanded, move the security perimeter so that delegates and alternates won't actually have to see many Milwaukeeans during the course of the July 15th and 18th convention. What? So because they come into our city, they don't want to see the people of the city, and they don't feel that the people of the city have any right, Dr. Kraig, to say anything to them about who they are, what they do, and then to demand that the Secret Service, what planet are these people on, Dr. Kraig? I mean, who's going to, and the fact of the matter is, I thought, Dr. Kraig, people have a right in this country, you know, to free speech. They want to stifle free speech, Dr. Kraig, because they're having a convention in Milwaukee. Shouldn't people be outraged by that, sir?
Yes. And you ask what planet they're on, Earl. They're on planet authoritarianism. I mean, this is where this strict construction of the Constitution is totally cherry-picked, where they distort the Second Amendment to give a right to semi-automatic weapons unimaginable at the founding. And you can't explain that amendment without understanding the first clause, the well-regulated militia. Why is that? Apparently just a drafting error. The founder just wrote that in there. So in this case, the First Amendment, free speech and free assembly come at the top. They're central and core to having a democracy. But they only believe in free speech and free assembly for themselves, right? So they want to be in Wisconsin because it's a swing state. The only place with the hotel capacity remotely is Milwaukee area, right? The only major city in Wisconsin. But then they want to be in a bubble, hermetically sealed from the people of the city. I really didn't like the where they were going to put the protest zones.
Right, I mean, neither did I.
I know that Mayor Johnson and his administration are trying to do their best, and the mayor's done great things like signing the Milwaukee Climate Economic Equity Plan. But I always thought that was a, as Raphael Smith and our staff called it, curated protest. You get an hour with their microphone and you're way off to the side. Well, apparently that's too close for the Republicans. You wonder at what point that we're not even supposed to be in the same country. I mean, it's almost like this is like a Disney production of a world that doesn't exist, right? So it just shows not only a complete intolerance of dissent, right? It doesn't grasp the idea that in a democracy there's going to be opposing positions and that there is some right on the part of others to be heard at one of the national conventions of one of the two great political parties in this state, in this country. And so I think it speaks for itself, Earl. But as you know, it's not, if it was only symbolic, that wouldn't be as dangerous as the fact that they, you know, have a party where the majority of voters have been convinced by their leaders that there was something nefarious in the 2020 election and Joe Biden is not legitimate. It's like back to the divine right of kings era where there were endless, you know, pretender kings and claims that the real king or the real queen weren't really the legitimate heirs to the throne. Once you undercut the legitimacy of a president that is duly elected and wins the popular vote by 7 million, then these other repercussions flow from it. But it's a symptom of the broader problem we're seeing right now, Earl, with the threat to democracy in this election.
You know, Dr. Kraig, the contrast couldn't be so stark. The Democrats are going to be in Chicago in August. Republicans are in Milwaukee in July. And just to show you how outlandish their behavior is, Democrats aren't demanding any of those things. So let's stop acting like this is not unusual, Dr. Kraig. It is unusual. And it's more than should be tolerated. You know, to demand that the Secret Service we don't want to walk past those people. What? You don't want to walk past the people of the city of Milwaukee? You come into our city and you claim, well, as if you're bringing something great to the city of Milwaukee? Because Republicans are coming into our city? You want to totally and to the mayor, I would say to our mayor, you know, people push back on this from the very beginning. And the mayor's position, well, this is not about Democrats or Republicans. This is about having our city shine. Well, he may see that from that perspective. But, Dr. Kraig, that's clearly not what the Republican, are seeing and looking at. They could care less about the people in the city of Milwaukee. As you stated, this is their opportunity. And Dr. Kraig, there wasn't anybody else who wanted them, right?
Well, I'm not sure, but I don't think there was a huge bidding war on.
There was one other place.
Nashville.
Right.
Nashville didn't really make a full bid, as I recall. Nor would they have made a full bid for the Brewers, but that's a debate from last year. I would just, you know, Nashville is the great boogeyman, apparently. Well, apparently the shining city means the buildings, right?
Right.
The convention center.
The lake.
And the hotels. It doesn't mean the people, the lake, right? And I don't want to give the Democrats a full pass yet. Let's see how that goes down. The Democrats are a coalition of people who believe in democracy, but there's a huge set of divergent views among them. While they're not making that demand, my understanding is that the city has been refusing permits for a Gaza protest. The last I heard, maybe there's been a breakthrough on that since I last talked to people down in Chicago. And the Democrats, to prove their pro-democracy mettle, are going to need to find a way for people who are not for Donald Trump, but who strongly disagree with President Biden's Gaza policy, to exercise their free speech on that. Now, that does not mean that Trump should be elected, because we have a binary choice here, and because we still have a better path towards peace in the Middle East with a Biden administration than with a Trump administration, okay, which will be completely four square behind Netanyahu. But nonetheless, I want to see the Democrats prove their Democrat muster by risking one of their greatest fears, which is a 1968 style scenario where the protests with Mayor Daley's police cracking down were so out of control, they damage the candidacy of Hubert Humphrey against Richard Nixon.
All right, 844-967-2789. Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action, and you on the Earl Ingram Show. Welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. It's Wednesday. That means Wednesdays with my special guest, Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action. So, Dr. Kraig, the jury is now deliberating. And and our nation is worried about what happens if Donald Trump is found guilty. Worried about, Dr. Kraig, what's going to happen? Will there be trouble? What's going on with us, Dr. Kraig? So if Donald Trump is found guilty, there are people who are threatening to do some things to make sure that there won't be peace. If Donald Trump is found guilty, they're going to react in some way physically. What is wrong with us, Dr. Kraig? I mean, Donald Trump has brought this on himself.
I mean, these are the early stage warning signs of authoritarianism and fascism. You see, a lot of it is not only direct violence, that's there, but the intimidation, right, the threat. And then we stop operating by rule of law. I mean, the fundamental founding concept of this country was to have no kings. I mean, that's why the Supreme Court basically putting on hold the January 6th case as they debate what should be a completely absurd proposition that that presidents are supposed to be immune even after they leave office, right? And that their presidents were immune from acts well beyond the power of and the duties of their office. President Trump had no duty to intervene in the Georgia, Arizona, and Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania, and Michigan elections. It's not part of his job as president, but they've put it on hold. This is a real threat to the rule of law. We have one jurisdiction that's gone forward. Remember, there are three legitimate cases that are all on hold right now, for the most part. Two because of judges, right? The U.S. Right. Supreme Court in the January 6th case and the documents case with that Trump-appointed judge that clearly is just in the tank for him. I mean, there's people can, if people want to call in and make an argument for her, go ahead. But that's just, I believe, just believing everything that's on your side ism. And then, of course, we had the whole blow up in Georgia with Fannie Willis, Fulton County District Attorney, and the affair she had with one of the lead prosecutors. And that has held the whole thing up. Nothing to do with Trump, right? We know that there's an absolute, smoking gun there with that recorded phone call with the Secretary of State. So we have one jurisdiction that's gone forward. It's the more complicated the cases. They've made a pretty darn strong case. Now, whether the jury finds Trump guilty beyond reasonable doubt, you have to find him guilty both of the underlying forgery of documents and directing that, and then that being a cover-up of a higher crime, which was a massive campaign expenditure unreported in order to make sure the Stormy Daniels controversy didn't blow up right after the Access Hollywood controversy and therefore completely sink his candidacy in 2016. As the prosecutor said yesterday, this is one of the most important political expenditures significant in American history, because it may have been flipped the presidency that this did not come out. So I would say, Earl, if democracy is to stand, then former President Trump needs to be under law just like the rest of us. It's authoritarianism that says that the dictator is somehow a higher law unto themselves. And frankly, that this trial moved to conclusion, but all of us need to realize if the jury doesn't find him guilty, they don't find him guilty, and our side has to accept that. But it certainly doesn't look put it this way, Earl. The New York authorities, the prosecutor, the judge have not stopped this case. The real question, Earl, is whether all of this, Trump has been found guilty, the judge has been reluctant to put him in jail, right, of contempt of court multiple times. What we'll find out later, if there's a hung jury and former President Trump is not convicted, Earl, whether any of the members of the jury heard all the threats and the intimidation and reacted that way. That would be scary. That would be creeping authoritarianism as well. But if they find him legitimately, the evidence not to amount to guilt beyond reasonable doubt, then they should acquit him. And we, our side, accept that as ones who believe in law and order. But the proposition you laid out, Earl, that somehow because there are threats of violence and illegality, that President Trump shouldn't be held accountable for crimes like anyone else, that's outrageously un-American. And what is scary is that a whole political party seems to support that position. They, on CNN, they had a focus group of Georgia voters, and no one changed sides from Trump to Biden based on a conviction. In other words, none of the Trump people yielded, even if he was convicted, in terms of their vote for Donald Trump.
So Dr. Kraig, Bill Maher, said this in a Sunday interview. During a Sunday interview, which was meant to promote Maher's forthcoming book, What This Comedian Said Will Shock You. Well, I think the basis of it is we started to hate each other, Maher replied, before leveling criticism on both Democrats and Republicans. When you hate people, you don't listen to them. So it doesn't matter how reasonably they might be. We have reached this space where each side thinks the other side is an existential threat. You hear that term from both sides all the time. That is just a terrible place to be. And I believe, this is Bill Maher, that we could be headed towards another civil war. Now, clearly, Dr. Kraig, when you see, and Bill Maher said both sides, and I don't see, I'm sorry, but I don't see that push coming from the Democratic side of things, Dr. Kraig. I just don't. But you know, people want to play it right down the middle. But what this is, Dr. Kraig, and the hate that is moving around this nation because somebody is a Democrat, or, you know, I don't know if Democrats hate Republicans, but I clearly know that Republicans, for the most part, hate Democrats. That's what I see. That's what I hear. Your thoughts on that and where we are?
It shows kind of the neurosis of centrism, Earl. Bill Maher is so committed to, as you said, down the middle, that he has to essentially say that well-grounded fears that Donald Trump wants to further undermine and remove the basic elements of democracy, right? Be a dictator. There's no dictator for a day, right? Now are described as and reframed as both sides are afraid of and hate the other. In any authoritarian controversy, it's like saying that the victims and the persecutors, well, they both hate each other and fear each other. Okay, well, aren't we morally committed to actually make an assessment of whether those are reasonable judgments, right? A persecuted group of people in an authoritarian country that's on the verge of authoritarianism, they have every right to fear those who are taking power and want to other them, blame them, target them. So it's amazing how resistant one's worldview that I'm in the middle and I make fun of both sides, right? In Bill Maher's case, ignores reality entirely. And ethics requires that one actually be honest about these things. I think too many Democrats actually hope that Republicans who are standing with Trump will see the light. And there's all this talk about the Nikki Haley voters and how we don't have to actually mobilize our own base, the folks who are with us, right? But we're going to find this magical group of Nikki Haley voters. Actually, the Democrats are constantly wishing the Republicans are going to see the light, right? We get all excited when after January 6th, Republicans are condemning Trump, but when it didn't take him down, just like Access Hollywood, there was a quick turnaround to showing fealty to their ruler, their leader. And so, and they're quietly, they quietly, all sorts of members of Congress, their reports to a Republican quietly say they're afraid of all this, but they won't say it publicly. So I'm sorry, yeah, Bill Maher, it's cowardice on his part and also blindness, moral blindness on his part.
Denoting civil war, and I personally believe, based on what I hear, you know, if Donald Trump doesn't win, there are people who are going to retaliate. That's just fact. I don't think that's the case, Dr. Kraig. There's nothing that shows me that people on the other side, people who are Democrats, are making threats that if Joe Biden doesn't win, there's going to be hell to pay. So I can't say they're one and the same, Dr. Kraig. There's nothing that I've heard or leads me to believe that if Joe Biden loses, Democrats are going to raise the kind of hell that Republicans are going to raise if Donald Trump loses. Am I living in a fantasy world, or am I missing something?
Well, there may be hell raised if Trump does even one-tenth of what's in the Project 2025.
As far as him winning. Once he wins and he starts doing those things, there will be hell to pay. But I'm talking about, go ahead.
It's a matter of who's causing the Civil War, right? So let's go back to the only Civil War we've had, right?
Right.
So many Southerners said, if you elect Lincoln, there'll be a Civil War. Should people have voted against Lincoln and capitulated to the South and continued slavery? I mean, that is literally, and would that have not created a non-functioning country where one section of the country governed the whole country because we were afraid of the irrational and violent actions they would take? Now, it will not be a civil war like that in the sense that there were two sections that had predominantly different opinions, and therefore you could have a geographic civil war. We're all mixed up more in this country. There are red parts of Wisconsin, right, and Illinois, right, and Minnesota, and blue parts, right, right? So it's not a civil war. It's more like civil unrest and division. I do think you might see blue states like California or Washington and Oregon trying to secede ultimately if Trump tries to, and the Republicans do what's in that 900-page 2025 plan, because it becomes a completely alien and oppressive republic to them. But at this point, we can't give in. This is authoritarianism playbook. Give in, we have to like capitulate because of the irrational, violent, unlawful things they will do if we pursue law and order and our constitutional system. That cannot be the motivation that is essentially causing authoritarianism without it having to take power.
844-967-2789 is the number. Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. Text us that same number. It's Wednesday. It means Wednesdays with my guest, Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action. Dr. Kraig, I'm worried. I get a little frustrated as I watch the Democratic Party and the positioning of themselves in this reelection bid. And I get frustrated because I think it just appears, Dr. Kraig, that the people who are heading it are not doing the things that are going to be necessary to get people to come out and vote. And there are people who clearly, Dr. Kraig, who are Democrats who are saying they're not going to vote for President Biden. And, when things like what took place a couple days ago in Rafah take place, and then the White House comes out and says, well, we don't see that there's been anything that Israel has done anything that leads us to, believe that, we can't support them, basically, is what they're saying. We can't keep doing that, Dr. Kraig. Your thoughts?
Yeah, and you start out in the campaign, and the campaign can't control what President Biden's Middle East policy is, right?
Right.
So, unfortunately, this seems to be a strong commitment from his 40 years in the Senate that he thinks you always stand with Israel. Just like I said, Bill Maher is not looking at reality. I think in this case, President Biden is not looking at reality and is sticking to his old kind of viewpoint on how the world should work. Frankly, there has to be some final settlement of the question if there's ever going to be peace for either Palestinians or Israelis. And the Israelis are very wrong to think they can be a fortress state and be secure. And they're making themselves less secure by making themselves a pariah state, by engaging in, I'll use the International Court of Justice's words, possible genocide. For all those who find that offensive, that is that, in other words, there need to be even further investigation to prove that the bar is so high for genocide, but it's really horrible thing to even have possible genocide. Certainly ethnic cleansing, it would appear, if you want another bad word. So here's the problem with Gaza. Well, first of all, the campaign can't control that. And campaigns, particularly national campaigns, are going to be hit from all sides. Everyone has an opinion. They got to follow a disciplined strategy. We can't see what most of it is this far out. A lot of it isn't going to be visible to the public. So I hope this is a damn shrewd and smart campaign strategy, because the future of democracy depends on it. Thing with Gaza is, I think the administration has felt, and this is true, that foreign policy is rarely a voting issue. In fact, the Iraq War in 2004 is the only one in half a century where research showed that that was the main driver. And so they've thought this will not be a big election issue. And there's polling to back that up. I mean, 70% of young voters, according to Harvard JFK School of Government poll, are anti-Biden's Gaza policy, but it's the number 15 priority for young voters when you rank the issues. Here's the thing, and this is also what I think happened in Afghanistan, where the botched pullout from Afghanistan, right. Biden was right to pull out, and did the hard thing, but the military misadvised him, and they did it poorly, and they misanalyzed how quickly the regime that would fall to the Taliban much more quickly than they thought. But that was the military and the Joint Chiefs of Staff giving him the wrong information. But that torpedoed his approval rings. They've never recovered. And it's not like people are voting on Afghanistan. I think Gaza creates this broader impression that Biden is a failure and that Biden is someone that our side can't support, even if the person doesn't conceptualize it in terms of the details of Gaza policy, right? And exactly what ought to happen. So I think that it is much more damaging than they think for that reason. They have this rabbit out of the hat idea that they're going to broker a Palestinian state with Saudi Arabia and Israel in the middle of this. They're working very hard on that. That seems very far-fetched. It's like waiting for the grand slam in the ninth inning, hoping for it and putting your whole game plan around it.
Right.
So I think this is a very dangerous situation. I think what voters, I want the Gaza policy to change. I'm outraged by it. I'm still going to vote for Joe Biden, because what we're choosing is not perfect people. We're choosing terrains, right? In which terrain is justice and equality more possible? In one, in an open democracy, Biden is with us on many issues like climate change, like antitrust, like paid family medical leave, child tax credit, which cut poverty 40 to 45%. He wants to do all of those things. He wants to do even more on climate and economic and racial equity. And he'll maintain a democracy where when we disagree with him, we can protest, we can try to move him, right? None of that exists with Trump. He will be in bed with Netanyahu. He will not listen to our side or social justice advocates or progressives or Democrats in any way, shape, or form. You've seen how Wisconsin's been run with the gerrymandered legislature. They do what they want to do. They don't care. It goes back to the protests of Act 10. They will ignore half the state and just do what they want to do. So when you're choosing those, it's a binary choice. This is what Biden, as people say, we need to get people the ethical choices to choose democracy, but it's a harder choice. And we have to convince a lot of young people who see no opportunity for themselves in their lives, especially young people of color, that there is still more opportunity for themselves in this other path. The student loan debt forgiveness, it's the Supreme Court that blocked it. He's done a bunch of it that he could still do legally, but it hasn't been enough to cut through. So this is why we need to talk to our own side and mobilize them, but we have to make a harder case than usual. We don't have a knight in shining armor to offer. We still need people to vote.
Yes, we do. We've got Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action, our knight in shining armor. Thank you very much, Dr. Kraig, as always. See you when you get back. Thank everybody who made the show go. Thank you, Calvin. I'll be joined tomorrow by none other than Joel McNally, award-winning journalist. Up next, Jane Matinere and Greg Bach, Matinere on Air. See you guys later.